So good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jinghua, and welcome to the climate change and wash methods and modeling session. And I'm today's chair, and I'm currently a PhD student in Loughborough University, working on the flood modeling. And another moderator today is Huili Chen. Huili, would you like to give a short introduction about yourself?
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Huili Chen, a lecturer in water engineering from Loughborough University. So I'm going to help Jinghua with moderating this session. So for our audience, if you have any technical questions, you can type them in the chat box. I will keep an eye on it. Thank you.
All right. So before starting, I'm going to give a short introduction about this, the workflow of this session. So we have three presentations in this session, and each of them have 10 minutes video playing, and with another 10 minutes Q&A time. So during the Q&A time, you can raise your hand, use the button, and enter the audio and video box. And my colleague will send you a video and audio request. Please receive it, or if you like, you can also type in your questions in the box, chat box. So we will collect your questions and ask them on behalf. So I guess maybe we can start right now for the presentation. So yeah, the first presentation comes from the Ruhil Iyer. The topic is integrating climate thinking for rural sanitation and hygiene programming.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for taking time to tune into our session today. My name is Ruhil Iyer. I'm a research officer at the Sanitation Learning Hub at the Institute of Urban Studies. And I am also presenting with Dr. Jeremy Kolitz, who is a research principal at the Institute for Sustainable Futures at the University of Technology, Sydney. So let's get right into it. Still lack access to basic sanitation. The SDGs aim to get everyone using safely managed facilities by 2030. However, climate hazards can potentially worsen existing sanitation issues and can either stop or even reverse the progress we've made so far. It can increase public health risks. So, in order to explore these issues further, the Institute for Sustainable Futures, University of Technology, Sydney, and the Sanitation Learning Hub undertook a detailed desk-based study last year. It involved reviewing literature within climate and sanitation, community-based adaptation, and infused with 19 rural sanitation practitioners and experts based in countries across Latin America, Africa, and Asia. We put all of this together into a Frontiers of Sanitation issue on climate and sanitation, published earlier this year. The illustrations you see is our contents page, and we have written about why the sanitation sector has been relatively slow to address climate issues, some overlaps in climate and sanitation related concepts and bridging that language, the various ways climate hazards impact rural sanitation and hygiene practices, ways to assess and respond to these impacts within programming, and some ideas and structures for collaboration and learning in the sector. In this presentation, we're going to be focusing on some of these aspects that I've outlined above. So, during our interviews with sanitation practitioners, we came across a number of barriers, but most significantly in how the climate change problem was perceived, how impacts are understood, and barriers towards appropriate engagement and responses. These are all also very interconnected. For instance, many practitioners told us how, because the climate change problem was already so complex, daunting, and cross-cutting, it was difficult to add these considerations to an already complex sanitation program. It also meant that it was difficult to separate climate risks from other environmental changes, and the links between climate change and rural sanitation were unclear. The uncertainty of climate change, along with all of the other barriers I mentioned, also meant that there were limited tools and actionable recommendations on how rural sanitation practitioners can effectively adapt and respond to hazards within their program. Therefore, many left it to be addressed at national and international levels and perceived it to be beyond their remit. We also explored how different kinds of climate hazards affected sanitation. We divided them into four main kinds of impacts. So slow onset events like droughts and desertification happened over a long term and incrementally. Shocks like cyclones and hurricanes that caused major disruptions in a very short amount of time. Trends like increased average annual rainfall over the recent past, and variability and unpredictability. So these included changing rainfall patterns and other hazards that wouldn't have been expected in the region. There is, of course, overlap amongst these, for instance, trends of increased cyclone and hurricanes in the recent past in an area. We also noticed a pattern in how these hazards impacted rural sanitation both directly and indirectly. And these were in four main ways. Impacts on behaviors like increasing and continual disruption to facilities caused a fatigue in people having to constantly respond and patch up their toilets. Physical access to sanitation like paths towards latrines becoming muddy and slippery and therefore difficult to use. Livelihoods in the form of people not wanting to prioritize sanitation when their main source of incomes had been affected. And resources and markets through the materials that would be needed to cope and manage their facilities. These are some quotes from practitioners we spoke to, and I will pause here for a few seconds to give you a chance to read. Climate change impacts sanitation via numerous interlinking pathways. Climate change creates or worsens climate hazards. Social context and local activities shape how these hazards impact and affect physical access to sanitation infrastructure, access to local resources and markets, and the livelihoods needed to support safe sanitation. These impacts and the burden of responding to them are felt differently across and within communities, depending on the social context. Negative impacts are disproportionately felt by those who are already vulnerable, and it exacerbates existing inequalities. A complex array of social factors combine to create inequities that cause some people to suffer from climate hazards more than others. For example, like the quality of their toilets and their decision-making power to adapt and respond. Psychological factors like risk attitudes, trust in expectations and authorities also contribute to determining whether people practice or change behaviors to proactively respond to climate impacts. In terms of physical access, climate hazards can damage or destroy facilities, disrupt the functionality of one, or make it difficult to access, particularly for people with physical limitations or older people or pregnant women or people with disabilities. Climate change can also cut off access to markets that provide products and services related to sanitation, particularly for those living in remote areas. Availability of water and other local resources for the construction and operation of sanitation facilities have also been affected in the past. It can affect people's livelihoods, which in turn affects their ability to meet their sanitation needs. The ways that sanitation and livelihoods are connected to climate change impacts are context-specific and can be difficult to predict. Therefore, climate change impacts sanitation via numerous interlinking pathways which are complex, dynamic, cross-cutting, non-linear, and are interpreted very subjectively based on personal experience and circumstances. We need actionable ideas to understand these and respond to these within the scope of sanitation and hygiene programming.
So now we're going to share some examples of actionable ideas for understanding and addressing climate impacts on rural sanitation. As presented in our framework, it's important to understand that sanitation access is only one of many potential concerns for rural communities regarding climate impacts. Good sanitation is practiced in the context of people's everyday lives, so if their everyday lives are being affected by climate, it'll have flow-on effects for sanitation. One way to assess how livelihoods and other local activities affect sanitation and hygiene is the impact diagram activity pictured here. This is a participatory activity whereby community members use picture cards to illustrate the linkages between climate, features of the community, and sanitation. So by doing this activity, it facilitates a discussion of all the ways that climate hazards like floods and droughts affect life in the community and ties the various impacts together. This provides important context about other climate impacts that people have to deal with that directly inhibit sanitation access. It's also important to understand the social context in a community and how that shapes how people experience climate impacts. An example of how to do this is through a participatory activity to discuss the norms around household wash workload and decision making. In this activity, household members identify who in their family has certain sanitation responsibilities, like collecting water for flushing or repairing the latrine. They also identify who in the household makes decisions about sanitation. Then, they discuss how extreme dry or wet weather affects their workloads and how decisions are made. This activity can give important insights about unequal impacts of climate on sanitation. Another way to explore the social context is to include formative research on people's sanitation and hygiene behaviors when extreme weather is experienced. Now, we'll share a few interventions we can take to improve the situation. There's more to climate-resilient sanitation than just stronger raised latrines. Stronger latrines could work well, but they also might cost more to build. So, in some situations, it might make more sense to construct certain parts of the latrine, like the superstructure, out of materials that can be quickly rebuilt with local materials. One thing we could do is develop a process for deciding when to focus on building stronger, more robust latrines, and when to build more easily repairable ones. We could also support communities and other stakeholders to make more informed choices about the types of latrines they choose to build. For instance, many people aspire to build a flush toilet, but will that be sustainable in an area that is facing increasing water scarcity in the dry season? We could facilitate people to think through the various climate risks for different sanitation options and choose an option that will provide access year-round. For example, maybe they could use household flush toilets most of the year, but use shared dry toilets when there are severe water shortages. Finally, climate change adds another layer onto the debate about the use of financial support mechanisms. We should consider further whether people can really afford climate-resilient sanitation options and whether financial support is needed. We could also work with service providers more to ensure that communities have access to the right products and services. In order to better accommodate climate risks, modified sanitation products or latrine designs might be needed. We could work with service providers on how their products could be redesigned to be more resilient and to market those to communities. Sanitation entrepreneurs and service providers should also consider seasonality and climate hazards in their business and operational plans. For example, if any emptying service cannot access certain areas during the wet season when demand is highest due to flooded roads, they should perhaps schedule emptying to occur just before the wet season starts. We could work with service providers to better consider how to adjust to climate risks in their operations. Following on that, we could also build the capacity of entrepreneurs and service providers to monitor weather and climate warnings. This might include giving them information on where they can go to access early warnings and what to do if extreme weather is being predicted. Ideas and more. You can read more about these actionable ideas and more in our Frontiers of Sanitation issue on Rural Sanitation and Climate Change, which is available on the Sanitation Learning Hub website. Also, be on the lookout for forthcoming case studies from ISFUTS and the Sanitation Learning Hub on how climate affects rural sanitation and what can be done to respond. Ongoing discussions about climate change and rural sanitation are also now being facilitated on the online Sustainable Sanitation Alliance Forum, so please join us there as well. Thank you for your attention.
So I'm sorry, Huili had disconnected because of the poor internet. So I'll send the audio request to the Ruhil. Any questions right now? So if you have any questions, please raise your hand or send the audio cast directly. Yeah, I think we got a question from the chat box. It's from the Aziz, and the question is how we can work on perception and behavior or community to change their water consumption based on the climate change. I think it's not easy. Would you propose a solution?
I agree. Sorry, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great. Hi, Aziz. I agree. It's not very easy. I think any kind of behavior change or work is not very easy. I think the key here is also to understand the different patterns of water consumption based on household, different gender roles, people involved in different aspects of water management within a household and a rural setting. So I think there's more to say on who we speak to about different things. For example, women will be more in charge of household water supply, bringing water for food and washing and cleaning. And also a lot of water will then be used, I mean, assuming farming livelihoods, etc. So I think the idea would be to, yes, I mean, if changing their water consumption patterns is necessary, yes, but also I would say you really need to we need to look into identifying the different people's relationship and responsibilities around water and sort of take it from there.
Okay, thank you for your answer. And any other one have questions? I think the Alex is typing, I think, so maybe we can wait for another minute. Yeah.
Yes, sure.
Yeah. So if you would like to, here it is. Have you conducted cost-benefit analysis of affordability for rural poor community while integrating climate change impact?
Can I just clarify this question? Do you mean cost-benefit analysis for affording toilets or affording specific parts of latrines? I'm assuming it's about toilets. So I'm going to say, no, we have not conducted a cost-benefit analysis. But from previous experience, we obviously know that different households will find different, will find affordability an issue in different ways. Main idea here was to look at experiential learning around how people perceive climate impacts and the various associated impacts it has on their sanitation programming in many different parts of their life and around sanitation practices, sanitation behaviors, etc. So nothing specifically on cost benefit analysis, but we do know that the affordability of latrines decreases drastically when there are climate impacts because people will always have other priorities for spending their money. So for example, if people lose their livestock or livelihoods or crops fail because of floods or droughts, people are less likely to be able to also afford fixes or maintenance for their toilets and latrines or hand washing services and things like that. So people do not tend to prioritize sanitation facilities when there are other lots of other climate impacts on their life.
Thank you. Hope the Ruhil answer really answers your questions. Anyone else? Okay, so if there's no other questions, we will move on for the next presentation. The next one is the methodological comparison for wash-related climate vulnerability assessments from the Abrams. So let's start.
This is a methodological comparison for wash-related climate vulnerability assessments presented by Amber Abrams on behalf of the Future Water team. I will present an introduction, background, methods, findings, and discussion. Access to wash in countries like South Africa is inequitable and in many cases inadequate. While wash services are key to maintaining well-being, climate-related shifts in rain, for example, may further challenge access to wash. Combined, these issues make the already vulnerable settlements and peoples even more vulnerable. This presentation is a component of a project that aimed to contribute to guidance on developing climate change and wash vulnerability and adaptation assessments. For the analysis, we made use of a transdisciplinary team at Future Water, but the research projects were done in different ways, which we will explain shortly. We made use of a rapid approach to explore the needs, barriers, and vulnerabilities of WASH. Our rapid timeline, which was less than 3 months, further challenged by COVID restrictions, meant that we had to take up pragmatic methods. And in this case, we compared two case studies that we developed from data already collected. The aim of these pragmatic methods was to develop overall, a climate vulnerability assessment in the context of WASH, as well as guidance on how best to approach such assessments with limited data and time. The presentation I'm going to give you now outlines the different methods used in each case study and compares benefits and lessons learned from these different methods. We had to make a plan. Our methods pre-COVID, our proposal included fieldwork, ground truthing as a key component. However, COVID influenced our fieldwork as well as our contract time, and instead of having more than 6 months to do this research, we had less than three. We had to take a pragmatic approach, which meant we drew on context where we already had in-depth knowledge and or data. These were two sites, one in rural northern Limpopo, a small village, and another, a small town in the Western Cape. Very different contexts historically, however, comparatively as far as government intervention, we thought they might be similar. We wanted to see. We already had gathered these data for other projects. However, we understood that WASH assessments might allow us to look at these projects with the data we had already gathered. In Limpopo, we drew on methods from a PhD research project, my own, focused on well-being, that took place from 2013 through 2016. This was in-depth ethnographic research over more than 4 years that included participant observation and participatory methods. Participatory methods included photo voice, as well as walking transects, walking interviews, and participant observation meant that I spent more than 4 years working in the space, living with people, and sharing their lives. What we found in participatory methods like photo voice was water access was an emergent theme. This project never intended to focus on water, however, it ended up doing so. What we also found is that participant observation showed a lot of insight into how committees emerged to answer the water access concerns and how work crews developed around needs that were resulting from drainage issues as well as water access concerns. Key findings from our WASH assessments in the Limpopo context included the recurring topic that water access concerns were a serious challenge to residents. These water access concerns were wide-ranging. People noted that there were multiple gatekeepers, and they were based on relations. Who you knew helped you get access to water. We also noted that there were emergent committees and responses to deal with water concerns and access problems, as well as drainage concerns. So a water committee developed around accessing water to collect funds from residents and develop a pump system from those funds, and the community works program itself began to respond to where the municipality was not providing water access or drainage support and road infrastructure. So we noted that there were indicators that were not always considered in standard assessments, and for this context, it included things like weather changes to local knowledge and how that impacted people's daily lives and responses to extreme weather events. This also included infrastructure failures, noting that tap counts don't suffice. It's not just a count if the tap is there, it's important if the tap is working. And that governance failures led to emerging committees and responses. We noted that supply chain concerns linked to extreme weather events, which were linked to transport concerns, meant that there were cascading concerns and challenges related to access to wash, and that apartheid and colonial legacies still haunt wash access today. In addition, we also noted that wash access concerns had financial implications that had downstream effects, including mental health challenges around well-being and access to water. Here is an example of emergent themes highlighted through photo voice. The example here is water access concerns. In Western Cape, we made use of a transdisciplinary team to explore a socio-hydrological assessment method focused on water management. This research was a short period of participant observation, a single two-day visit, but it involved focus group discussions, transect walks, semi-structured interviews with a multiplicity of researchers as well as respondents. We also included alongside that a desk-based review of policies and published the report in 2019. ON et al. Is the example. In the Western Cape, we found from our WASH assessments very similar things to the Limpopo case study, that apartheid era policies were still in place, in this case through deed-based access to water, that extreme weather events impact downstream peoples and concerns later on, and that indicators that are not always considered in standard assessments are very prevalent to this context. So for example, research during drought, the fact that infrastructure failures and a lack of investment, for example, in this case study specific to a water research project, a recharge project, were not completed. That supply chain concerns, again, in this context, are linked to extreme weather events, which link to transport concerns and cascading concerns. And that apartheid and colonial legacies haunt WASH today. That WASH access concerns have financial implications for everyday life, and that community collections were necessary in order to access water. Different in this case study was that third-party installation of things like boreholes lacked oversight. And again, this points to a fragmented governance. Here, in this case study, where agricultural activities are key to income sources, on top of drought and job loss, WASH challenges influence well-being from a mental health point of view. So comparing methods. In Limpopo, we used a single researcher. In Western Cape, it was a transdisciplinary research team, which involved social anthropologists, public health researchers, hydrologists, microbiologists, and many more. In Limpopo, it was 4+ years of field research, whereas in the Western Cape, it was a 2-day visit plus 6+ months of desk-based analysis. In Limpopo, we developed in-depth and close relations with over long periods of time, whereas in the Western Cape, relations were limited. Our research was an overview with a brief visit with very limited contact time. In Limpopo, we had multiple forms of engagement with all residents, whereas in the Western Cape, we made use of multiple forms of engagement, but with key stakeholders. What we did learn is that these two very different case studies in two very different contexts, however, had very similar WASH vulnerabilities. And from that, we suggest that storylines or case study narratives add important insights to standard assessments and tools. So when we compare themes and we look at the influence of different methods, when we looked at both sites around the question of community cohesion assessments, we could see in Limpopo, from being in the field from 4+ years, addressing this question was relatively simple, that water committees emerged, but it took 2 years to understand these water committees, and that drainage repairs by the Community Works Program were an integral part of their daily work, and it was a response to the fact that the municipality was not providing that. But this was only known because the researchers spent months with the Community Works Programs in their decision-making and in their activities, so their digging of drains and fixing of roads. So while we could speak very easily about community cohesion in Limpopo, because our research in the Western Cape was so short, we found it very difficult to determine from our limited interactions what might have happened with WASH locally. It was hard to see what emergent groups were forming from our limited stakeholder engagement, and the detail we had from the Hamakuya case study or the Limpopo case study made it very evident that one of the gaps in such a short research project would be in understanding the social dynamics of groups like this, or emergent groups like this, community cohesion. So when it comes to certain aspects of these assessments, what is clear to us is that each of these different methods had some benefits and some shortfalls. So when we compare these methods, we can see the benefits and limitations of both efforts. In the first context, with lots and lots of time, you have in-depth, detailed understanding, but this research is expensive, it's slow, and it's socially quite difficult, as people have lots of expectations when you spend a lot of time with them. In this research setting in Limpopo, there was only a single researcher. So that single researcher's specific focus might have field blinders, there might be some aspects not attended to, and there are definitely certain skill sets like hydrology that I, as a researcher, am not skilled in. Whereas on the other hand, a big team might have too many researchers. In our case, there were times where it was difficult to focus or manage our interviews across the multiple topics, but we do know this is possible and we did succeed in doing it. With the limited time, we became aware of that we know that there are emergent groups, but we totally lacked an understanding of the organization of these emergent groups. So what we suggest is that there needs to be a balance between these extremes, multiple capacities in both field and time, but a duration of time that isn't too short. And that we also have learned that citizens are experts in their own lives. So our findings and emergent themes are that there's key factors for the South African context that need consideration in WASH assessments. And these include all of the things that I highlighted already, weather changes, infrastructure failures or investments, community responses, extreme weather events and how it impacts on supply chain, political oversight or fragmentation, particularly colonial and apartheid legacies for South Africa, but very true for other parts of Africa and globally, in fact. And then the knock-on or downstream economic impacts and how those influence health and well-being. What we do know is that these are cascading, interwoving, and overlapping impacts, and they influence and challenge everyday lives and people's experiences with gaining access to WASH. Comparing the different methods and looking at our lessons learned, we understand that despite different contexts, similar WASH vulnerabilities exist. Managing and understanding WASH in the diverse South African context requires dealing with a combination of understandings of both the biophysical, historical, and social, and that drawing on standard tools is useful but never in isolation because they miss very key impacts or influences of lived experiences. And that in South Africa, there's a need to build an explicit WASH climate risk vulnerability assessment literature. And so in conclusion, we say that South African and rural small town WASH access is influenced by intertwined aspects of history, natural elements, and socioeconomics. That WASH climate risk vulnerability assessments must engage with literature and practice beyond climate change discourse or standardized assessments. We know that our work indicates the importance of fieldwork and engaging outside of the academic sphere or with standard stakeholder groups, and that standardized methods using quick assessments miss out relevant details. Our case studies highlight that key contextual information and pinch points for vulnerabilities provide insights, important ones, and that based on primary data collected for other projects, we do acknowledge that there are gaps in our understanding, but being pragmatic is useful when there is no other option.
Many thanks. Thank you for the Amber presentation. So any questions for her speech? So if you have any questions, just raise your hand or type in the chat box. Anyone? I guess Alex has typed in the chat box. So her question is,
Thanks, Alex. When I say too many researchers, it's a complicated question because we were a research team trying to explore how a transdisciplinary team would come together and conduct an interview so that all the disciplines were reflected that we're trying to understand the space. I don't have a particular number limit. I think it's just really important to understand the different players and what they're trying to get to. And if there is crossover, then a kind of group interview is possible. But it may be that you need to do two different types of interviews with the same stakeholder, for example. And when I say a lot of time, so in the research site that I worked in for the Limpopo case study, I worked in the area for 4 years. And the first year of that experience didn't involve any research. It just really involved learning the language and getting to know people, to understand people dynamics. So not a lot of funding opportunities will give you the space to do 4 years of research. And that's why I said it's probably not a very possible setting to have the same type of exposure to a place that I had for my PhD, for example. I hope that answers your question. Prioritize indicators for standards. Well, we're working with teams who are doing that, but that wasn't our primary goal. Our primary goal was to test indicators that were in place to see if they worked. And what we found is in many settings, there wasn't the data to be able to report on whether the indicators are useful or not. And so for that reason, the indicators became less useful and the case studies became important.
All right, thanks. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Alex, as well. So,
I also one question.
Yeah, of course.
Sure. Okay. Yeah, I'm wondering, are these two methods are common or representative for WASH vulnerability assessment?
Say that again, ask me that question again.
Yeah, I'm wondering, are these two methods are common or representative for WASH vulnerability assessment? So they are common?
Some of the measures, yes, the measures we used were all off of standard WHO measures and standard sanitation and hygiene guidelines. But what we found in a lot of the settings was that the data wasn't available unless you spent a long time figuring it out yourself. So there wasn't readily available data sets. And that's why we're advocating for a kind of case study approach, especially in places where the data isn't so available, but understanding is necessary. So informal settlements where people rent out backyards and they don't have water access, those types of spaces become, they put a lot of pressure on a WASH system, but they aren't really quantitatively taken into account because they're often not formal.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. So if you have any questions, just raise your hand. Otherwise, we will move on to the next presentation. Yeah. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Amber.
Have a nice day. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. So the last presentation is from the Maxim. The title is Hydrological and Hydraulic Modeling of Concrete Field Plug Operation for Small Dams.
Good day, everyone, and welcome to this presentation on the hydrological and hydraulic modeling of concrete fuse plug operation for small dams. My name is Maxim Fortin, and I'm a water resources engineer based in Canada, specializing in WASH and flood management and modeling. So this research project was completed as part of my WEDC master's program and in close collaboration with Co-Water International in the Essed Sahel project in Burkina Faso. The research project aim and objectives were to assess the use of concrete fuse plugs to increase the storage capacity of an existing dam called Yakuta. Then I wanted to identify low-cost hydrological and hydraulic modeling methodologies for mapping flood risk associated with this and testing this methodology with the concrete fuse plug on the Yakuta dam. Before I start into the details of this project, I wanted to first introduce the concept. Concrete fuse plugs were introduced around 2010 by the International Commission on Large Dams. They consist of concrete blocks that you install in an existing spillway, and that means that you can store more water in the reservoir upstream of it. However, the thing is that these blocks are sized to be freestanding until there is a certain water level that is reached upstream, after which the block, they stilt and they are ejected out of the spillway, and the spillway goes back to its original configuration. So these blocks can be used and designed to increase dam safety or to increase the available storage. There are a few documentations of installations in Vietnam and Burkina Faso, but not a lot. That's why most people still haven't heard of this technology. So here we see a cross-section view of the fuse plug and a front view where you would have different blocks sitting next to each other in the spillway. And as I mentioned, the configuration, depending on if you want to increase the safety or the storage of your existing dam. So the research plan, as usual, started with a literature review. And then we did a concrete fuse plug design at the preliminary level. Then we proceeded with the hydraulic modeling in 2D. And finally, the analysis of the data and results. So our case study today is centered on the Yakuta Dam, which is a key component of the Ased Sahel project. The Ased Sahel is a large drinking water supply project located in the Sahel region of Burkina Faso. It consisted of two phases. The first phase aims to supply drinking water to the city of Dori and 20 neighboring villages for around 40,000 people. That's been completed last year after around 4 to 5 years of work. And the second phase that is still under preparation aims to extend and expand the water supply to other towns to reach a total population of around 100,000 people. So the Yakuta Dam is an earth embankment dam that was completed in 2005. It's around 700 meters long, 9 meters high, and has a storage capacity of 26 million cubic meters on the Gudebo River. So when we were preparing the project, we saw that we did an hydrological study that showed that there was a risk of water deficit every 8 years, which was below the set criteria if the phase two was to be implemented. So that means that based on the water demand, the Yakuta reservoir would be running dry by the end of the dry season, approximately every 8 years, which is not good. And there was a recommendation to increase the storage by increasing the elevation of the spillway by an extra 50 centimeters, which would give around 9 million cubic meters of storage and would really help in terms of eliminating this risk of water deficit. And that is why the concrete fuse plugs were considered. So here we see a map of the project area in the Sahel region of Burkina Faso on the left. And finally, a project map where you see the Yakuta Dam and the city of Dori located east of it. So that's the phase one of the project. And then the towns of Gorom Gorom and Falaguntu, which would be the phase two of the project. So Falaguntu is located around 50 kilometers on the Gudebo River from Yakuta. Here are photos of the dam with the spillway on the left and a view of the embankment on the right. And so this research project was developed based on this context, and we wanted to see if the fuse plugs were a viable alternative to increase the storage. We wanted to see if the tilting of the fuse plugs when there is the trigger flood would create a flood wave that would be problematic for the communities located downstream. And finally, we wanted to see if we could use free software tools and data sets to assess this flood risk. The first step, that was the design of the fuse plug, followed a methodology that was developed by Hydro Co-op. You can find more details in the bibliography. It's basically sizing the depth and the height of the blocks and how many blocks you need for your installation. Then the hydrological and hydraulic modeling was done first with the 100-year inflow design flood from the existing dam study. So this is the flood that occurs on average every 100 years, and that would trigger the tilting of the concrete block as part of this design. Then the modeling was done using the global digital elevation model made available for the whole planet by NASA, which is great coverage, but the inaccuracy is quite high in terms of vertical error at around 8 meters relative. And finally, this DTM was modified to add the bathymetry of the water course. The modeling was done in 2D with the ECRAS software, that is a free software, and with QGIS, both free options. The operation of the fuse plug was simulated using a dam breach function of ECRAS, such as an overtopping. And it was evaluated based on three scenarios, where it's basically the baseline, nothing happens, and after that, tilting over 1 minute and over 12 hours, because you could design it so that it's progressive as the water level increases. So here we see the dam breach shape definition on the left. And on the right, we see a map of the comparison points. So at the discharge point, an intermediate point located in the middle between the dam and Falagun 2, and finally at the town of Falagun 2. So after a lot of work, the model produced results, simulation results that can be seen here, where you would see the reservoir filling up and then the flood wave traveling down the stream, traveling down the Gudebo River. So you see here examples of the results on the DTM or on satellite imagery. The results were analyzed also in terms of flow over time at the different comparison points. Here in blue, you see the, let's say the time zero where the blocks tilt, and then there's the flood wave that travels. So about 12 hours later, it reaches the middle point, and around 24 hours later, it reaches the flood wave, reaches the town of Falagun 2. And you can see that on the second graph here with the water level increase of about 22 centimeters in Falagun 2, and then it goes down back to normal. So the flood risk was assessed in Falagun 2. It was found to be not a big increase caused by the fuse plug, because the houses that were at risk were already flooded during the 100-year flood anyways. So they're not flooded as a result of this additional installation. But still, it's indicative that there is a vulnerability to flood in this community. So in conclusion, the concrete fuse plug was designed and tested to increase the water storage capacity in Yakuta. The methodology was developed. It showed results that can be indicative of a rough order of magnitude for the flood risk, but there's many limitations. Mostly the climate change variability for rainfall was not well considered because we took a design rainfall event. The DTM is very inaccurate. We will need to do bathymetric surveys and LIDAR surveys. And integrate more details into the model and do a full calibration. That was not possible, unfortunately, due to time constraints and also the security risk in the area. So thank you very much for listening, and I remain available to answer any questions.
Thanks for the Maxim presentation. So Maxim, if you are here, could you please raise up your hand or just type something in the chat box so that we can send you the video request to answer the questions. Hi, Maxim. All right, so. Oh, unfortunately, I guess he's not here. So, regarding to his presentation, if you have any questions or interested in his studies, maybe you can contact with him through the his email. We will put his email in the chat box so that you can contact him directly to ask your questions. As we cannot find him here. Here the email address in the chat box, yeah, it's his email address, so you can send your questions to him directly. For the other presentations, if you have any questions, we can use the left time tool to answer, especially for the Ruhil, I think she's still there, yeah. So if you have any other questions for Ruhil's presentation, please type your questions or raise your hand. Hi, Kenan, I'm sorry. I guess he's not here to answer your questions. Yeah. Please send your question to his email. So if you don't have any other questions for the Ruhil or Amber's presentation, I guess we will finish this session in advance. If we would like to recommend you to go to the coffee area, cafeteria, to discuss your questions or and your topic. So hopefully you enjoy your session and have a nice day. Mm-hmm.